Hello, y'all. I am back again for another video, and I am praying and hoping that you are having an excellent day. I'm back on this exercise bike, y'all, and this is very much needed. So this video is going to be about some complicated things, and when you put more thought into it, I mentioned this in another video, putting more thought into it. So I did a video about when your no contact is questioned. And so I put more thought into it, right? And so a lot of times, y'all, it's no such thing as thinking too deep, okay? It's nothing wrong with, what's the correct name? Analyzing, reviewing, looking back at, what would be the correct word for it? Evaluating, I guess. Reevaluating. Okay, that would be the perfect word. Reevaluating a question. And sometimes, y'all, I just want to get you to understand this. Sometimes people are too comfortable with you. And it's a difference if I'm a life coach, right? And I say, you can ask me anything. But people shouldn't feel too comfortable to ask you anything about yourself. Okay, and this is why. What they're doing is questioning your ability to make choices. Okay, so, and you have a right to make choices. So when I look at the question, and when I did the video, when your no contact is questioned, it was about my deceased relative that passed away. Now, I'm just going to be honest. The lady that asked me, my friend, and the lady that asked me, why didn't I see her more? She asked it to me, it's more like a judgment type thing. But when my other relative or my relative asked me, it wasn't so much of a judgment. I didn't get the judgment part of it. It was just more like a question. I also feel like due to the length of time and our history and stuff like that, I don't know. It's just a difference. My relative that asked me a question is not always gaslighting me versus the lady friend that I'm not in contact with right now. She does a lot of gaslighting. And so it's just a difference. So I thought about it. I said, I reevaluated it. And I've been doing that. And that's actually one of the things that I think in some cases will run some friends off if they don't have good intentions towards you and they're kind of toxic, right? Putting more thought into it. So I put more thought into it. I said, wow, that question can be borderline disrespectful. And that question could kill some people. What if you, I mean, it's just a question I wouldn't ask. If someone in your life died, whether it was a relative or not, I don't ask people those type of questions. I just don't. I think my empathy level and my ability to be able to feel sorry for somebody just wouldn't allow me to ask it. I ain't never asked it. I've been around people that have had friends and relatives die, and I didn't ask them, why didn't they go see them more? I just don't. And one reason I wouldn't ask somebody a question like that is because I don't feel like you are the only one that should have went to see them. I feel like if someone dies and they wasn't seeing each other very often and they're adults, I'm asking this about an adult, not a five-year-old. So I wouldn't ask it if it was your five-year-old. I just don't ask those type of questions. It's just a certain respect. I'm more focused on helping people heal. Like, I'm sorry your relative died. I'm sorry your friend died. I never have asked somebody why didn't you go see him more? I don't ask people when the last time they saw him. I don't ask questions like that. So I think what it may be is I may have better boundaries than the lady friend. And I know that automatically. I know her boundaries suck, y'all. Okay. This is a lady that will ask me if I just killed somebody and put them in the backyard. She is not afraid to ask questions. Okay. She doesn't care how it offends you. You could be telling this lady, look, I never killed nobody. And these are the type of conversations you can literally have with her. I'm just giving you an extreme example. I could say, I never killed anybody. I told you I never killed anybody. So why are you asking me, is somebody buried in the backyard? So that's just an extreme example. But when I do my playlist on the gaslighting friend, you will see what I mean and why I use that example, because she would do it. I mean, and the reason she would do it is because she's into assassinating your character, and she doesn't understand or doesn't give a damn that she's assassinating your character. I'll give you one example, okay? Like I said, I'm in no contact with her, but I'll give you one example. I was on the phone and I did a video when I talked about my sons were runaways, and that's cleared up. One son moved out and I'm in communication with him, and the other son is still at home. And two sons are still at home, but yeah, so there's three. I have three sons total. And we were on the phone, right? And so she could hear, and I've known this lady a very long time, so she could hear that I was pissed off. My son had did something. Because even when he came back home, he was still doing this, trying to leave. And, you know, every 2 months you want to leave and leave the door unlocked and stuff like that. I don't remember what it was, but it was, I had to work on him remaining more respectful. Because what happens is when they do the runaway stuff, they're under peer pressure. And peer pressure just ain't drug addiction, y'all. Peer pressure is also picking up on other kids' habits. Like sometimes other kids, they were around kids that beat up on their mamas, y'all. I mean, one little toxic girl beats the crap out of her own mama. So see, when your sons and daughters start hanging around people like that, that's a form of peer pressure. So they may be like, well, I want to talk crap. You know, well, this person beat up on their mama. Well, I can at least go home and tell my mama to fuck off. So see, peer pressure is much more than just drug addiction. So it's taking some time. So I would say I'm very proud of my son. All my sons, they're doing the best that they could do. However, I was on this phone conversation and I was pissed at him. You know, I was raising my voice and telling him how I feel, and he wanted to talk back, and I raised my voice and he raised his. And of course I conquered that, because I'm the mom. I'm a keep raising my voice higher than yours, because I am the mother, you are the son. And so I went off on his little butt, you know. That temperament rose up out of me. Like, you're not going to disrespect me. So I remember her saying on that phone conversation, you sound like you drunk. So here goes the character assassination. So the thing is with me, y'all, I can go 4 or 5 years without a drink. Matter of fact, I didn't even start even considering a drink. I was well into my 30s, right? So it's kind of like this. Okay, I go to the doctor. I'm at the doctor's, right? And the questionnaire is, are you a drinker? And I'm thinking, well, I do have a drink once every 4 years, once every 3 years. I don't bring alcohol in the home. Everybody that knows me knows that about me. There's no alcohol stored in my home. And I'm not downgrading you if you store it in the home. I just think it should be stored properly. Like it should be locked up where kids can't get to it. So I'm not saying someone that has any alcohol in the home that's stored is bad. I just don't do it. I never have. I wasn't raised where it was stored in the home. And if it was, I didn't know about it. My mom was a non-drinker and smoker. So that's pretty much something that... Sorry about that, y'all. That was my son's alarm. So the thing is, I was raised... I wasn't in homes like that. I mean, I was in a lot of Christian homes. My mom was a Christian. And my grandmother, she wasn't turning the liquor up neither. I wasn't around a bunch of people that was guzzling it down. I wasn't in environments where I seen a lot of liquor stored or any liquor at all. I just remember every home I went in, I never seen liquor around. I never seen people drinking. So I contribute what I do now to how I was raised. So I just, what they say, raise a child in the way he shall go. And he or she will always come back to it. So I think that helped me. And I'm just, it's a habit of, I'm used to, I'm stuck in my ways, y'all. I just don't bring it in the home. So that's a strength in my life. So it's very insulting when you have a friend just because she hears you angry. Now, keep in mind, when I was angry, I'm speaking clearly. There's no stuttering. I may have used a couple of cuss words because my son was tripping and we was having a family dispute. And I just happened to be on the phone with her. But, and I corrected her. I said, no, I don't sound drunk because I'm not drinking. I sound angry and I sound pissed off, but I don't sound drunk. And so that's somebody that's also antagonizing you. Like they're making it bigger than what it is. And also, if they're really trying to help you, they would just focus and just say what you're doing, not add to it. It's like somebody, it would be like a police officer see that you got weed on you and he see marijuana in your hand, but then he lies and says, oh, I think you got cocaine and some needles in your hand, your other hand or pocket. It's the lying. It's a form of lying. It just is a lie, and it's a character assassination. And I wouldn't have said it if I knew somebody didn't bring alcohol in their home. And they literally are the type of person that will only have a drink every 3 to 4 years, if that. So just say 10 years go by. I could have had 2 drinks. Okay, so going back to the doctor's story, I'm just going to point this out. So going for my yearly exam or evaluation, answering the questionnaire, are you a drinker? I'm like, okay, I'll check yes, right? And I used to just check no when I didn't drink at all. Like if I went 10 years with no drink, I would just check no, I don't drink, okay? But since I had decided maybe to have a glass of wine or something, or even a glass of vodka and cranberry like every 3 years, 5 years or whatever, I said, well, I'll put yes. So the doctor looked at me strange, like, because see, doctors know drinkers, right? So the doctor looking at me like, okay, you look, this is what the doctor felt. He said, well, you look very good for your age. He said, well, what you drinking? Because he looked at me up and down like, you don't look like you ever had a drink. And so when I said, you know, I have a drink every 3 to 5 years, just, he said, well, how many drinks? I said, one. And he said, he took the paperwork and he said to me, you know, I'm not encouraging you to lie on this paperwork, ma'am, but that's not what we mean. When we ask, are you a drinker? We're trying to assess your medical risk. And he explained to me, he said, And this is one of the like interns or whatever, like this is a family clinic where you're not always seeing the same doctor, so to speak. So, and I wasn't pregnant at the time. So if I'm in this family clinic and I'm pregnant, you basically kind of see the same person. But since I'm not pregnant, you know, you just see whomever. And so I did not. Okay, sorry about that, y'all. My son over here, the alarm going off again, right? So basically what the doctor was saying is we trying to assess risk. And for us to consider you somebody that drinks, we can't have nobody putting down they have a drink once every 30 years, y'all. That's how the doctor looked at it. So he took the paperwork and he scratched that out and he checked, no, you're a non-drinker. And he said, going forward, because you drink so rarely and you're telling me that you only drink one drink, it's not like you saying, well, you know, well, I drink every 3 years, but I drink 8 drinks in the same day. I drink 8 glasses of vodka and cranberry. So, and I get it, you know, they're trying to assess risk. And so one drink every 3 to 5 years, they don't consider that like a high risk of anything. I'm not even if I had high blood pressure and I would have had it at that time, which I didn't. Even somebody with high blood pressure could have one drink every 3 to 5 years. So that's the situation with that. So, and I'm not, and at this point, I'm not even meeting that standard. I'm just not drinking at all. And actually what I do drink, y'all, is alcohol-free wine. So I am drinking wine, but it's the wine with no alcohol. Okay. So that is what I drink now. And I bought 2 glasses of that, and I just not glasses, but bottles. Once I started buying alcohol-free wine, I fell in love with it. And I remember the same friend gaslighting me about that. She was judging me like, well, why do you buy wine? I said, well, this has no alcohol in it, ma'am. I mean, you know, she was almost like acting as if I'm a drunk because I buy alcohol-free wine. And certain occasions, like I had, I don't know why sometimes, like if somebody passed, I'll need a drink. And that's not often in somebody's past, but I didn't this time. I mean, when my relative passed the end of last year, I didn't drink anything. I didn't have a drink when I got back to the West Coast. I didn't have anything. So basically the doctor was basically saying, you need to check that you're a non-drinker. So overall, I mean, that was his perspective of it. And he just explained to me what they're looking for. Like, I'm not even having a drink every week, every month. It's just not consistent enough for me to be writing on some paper I'm a drinker. You know, because like he said, people that write on the paperwork that they're drinkers usually have more alcohol than that. So it was like a laugh out loud to him that I even, and he respected my honesty. He said, I really respect your honesty. Most people that had a drink that rarely would just say, no, they don't drink alcohol. And it was a big compliment because, you know, like he said, he know drinkers. And he could clearly see that I was pretty much a non-drinker in his eye because I just didn't give off none of that energy. And he also said he could tell that I was someone that never indulged in any drugs. I mean, he was just a good judge of character. I mean, he's dealt with a lot of patients and seen a lot of people, so he just can tell. And he said he can tell even when they don't look like ex-addicts. He just know things to look for when people have done drugs and alcohol. You know, he's talking about drugs outside of weed, y'all, not marijuana. He's talking about when they've done more. Even patients that have popped pills or going into addictions with like sleeping pills, he said he was really savvy at that. So to make a long story short, I forgot why was I even telling that story? That is so bad. I done forgot the total. Oh, because I mentioned the gaslighting example with the friend. So yeah, going back to when your question. So sometimes people they don't think before they answer questions, and it's just a form of disrespect. And when you're being questioned, why didn't you do something? So, you know, I believe in man-made deaths, y'all. And I believe in it more and more because I see so much proof of it, right? So I'm an evidence person. So for example, there was one sister on a video and she was saying she was with an abusive ex-husband. She left him after 5 years and he was physically abusing her. I think she said she had like a 3-year-old and a 2-year-old or 1-year-old. She had two little kids. One was 3, and I think the other one was even younger. And when she told him she was going to leave him, he attacked her and strangled her and stuff. And so immediately within 1 or 2 days, she went to an emergency domestic violence shelter. And she's alive right now doing videos. Now, I'm just going to do a comparison so I can prove my point of man-made deaths. And you could feel how you want to feel, but there's so much ludicrous stuff that's in the Bible, y'all. And one of them is when you was born, you had a destined day to die. And that's just the way you was going to die. And it's true for some people. It could be true for little girl or boy, and they end up dying at 5 from cancer. They were just destined to die in that way. And that's the way that happened. But usually that's not how most people's lives work. Most people actually contribute to their death. Okay. And I believe in death dates. Okay. I believe that most of us that live pretty normal lives, especially if we've been around psychopaths and narcissists and sociopaths, I believe that many of us have many death dates. However, you will only die on one of those death dates, if that makes sense. So for me, I've had at least 8 death dates. Okay. And one of your death dates, look at it this way, so I can prove my point further. Every time you get on a plane, every time you get in a car, that's a death date for you. However, your plane lands and you made it safely, right? So it just so happened that plane did not have any mechanical issues. No terrorist was on the plane and stuff like that. So I use the example of the sister that went into the domestic violence shelter. Now, I did a video about this where the father murdered his 3 boys. Okay. And that woman was in domestic violence with her husband, but she didn't leave. So he murdered and slaughtered all of their sons right in their front yard. She didn't go to a domestic violence shelter. And all the neighbors knew that he was abusing the kids and her. So the only one that lived in that situation was the stepdaughter and the mom. All the boys are dead. Now, I remember the mom in that video saying he destroyed her life. She destroyed her own life because she didn't leave. See, that wasn't when those boys were supposed to die. She made it that way. She made it where they died that day because she didn't leave the abusive father. Because, of course, she probably didn't believe that he would kill the kids. So, see, that's my evidence. Now, compare the first case where the sister, he choked her out and she left within a day or two. She was out of that man's house in 48 hours, left all the stuff and went to a DV shelter. Probably never got any of that stuff. She said she just got her a bag, got her some tote bags, and got out of there. But the other lady didn't leave. Okay, so if you go to a domestic violence shelter, there's a lot of protection for you. So with this being said, you know, I've had a lot to think about, and I've been doing the SAD management and stuff like that. And I'm not gonna lie, y'all, I kind of got some skills with dealing with people. I've gotten rid of as many people as some narcissists have. And when I say gotten rid of them, I mean just went no contact, got them out of my life, minimized contact. And this is why. In the beginning of the video, you heard that. Let me play it again so you could hear this. I don't know if you good with music. I think this, I got this in one of my playlists. And that's the intro music from Just Be Good to Me, okay? It's by, I'll put it in the description so I don't get a copyright claim. So you'll see the song down there. I'll put it in the description. So if you click on more, you'll hear the song. And I love this song. It's about 9 minutes. It's a good song to play. And so Just Be Good to Me, right? And so I thought about the situation more and more. These particular relatives, I mean, this relative that passed away and her father, they were, if the Lord asked me right now, how do you feel about them? I would say this. They never were grateful for me. Okay. Never. I mean, true gratefulness, like when you cherish somebody. And you know what, y'all? If somebody ain't grateful for you, they may not really love you. So I believe in that Just Be Good to Me. And I believe this, y'all. I believe that if somebody really loved me, for real loved me, and I'm talking about real healthy love, I have the inability to stop loving them. I do. I believe that. I believe that if you really cared about me, the universe will let me feel it. See, love has a something you could feel from miles and miles away. It's just real love. So what love ain't is abuse. So what I was kind of good at is I think I've always understood before I named it man-made deaths and death dates. I think I always understood and had a similar belief my entire life, but I just didn't name it anything. So one of the things about me is anyone that was violent or showed aggression, lied on me, were a backbiter, gaslighting, abusive, they never made it in my life. It's not meant, and I don't know if it's like prayers upon my life and things like that. It could be many things. I believe my mom, even though she didn't raise me every day, and I was with my grandmother a lot of the time during childhood, I believe that my mom wanted me to be happy. Okay. I believe that she wanted me to have a better situation than she had. And I also, another thing, anyone where I was just the supply source for them, you know, the term they use for narcissists, what they're using you for, they just want your money, they just want your sex, they just want to be around because of the vehicle. I was always pretty savvy with not getting used by somebody forever.
know how I'm gonna wake up from eating.
I'm woke. Y'all, we over here, this is my baby boy. We over here having a phone dispute. I'm like, oh my goodness, cut it off. So, yeah, I apologize for that. I put the video on pause because even though I don't have a bunch of viewers on every video, I do have some professionalism, and I don't like a bunch of noise in the background. Like, you shouldn't keep hearing an alarm. So anyway, it's we got it fixed, y'all. So thank you, son. Yeah, he fixed it. So it went off three times, y'all. So he has a meeting to go to. So that's why it's on in the first place. So I'm proud of him for that. So anyway, my ability to continue to love somebody when they don't love me. So, like I said, man-made death. So, okay, I don't do violence, right? So, and I'm gonna just say this, y'all. It's a quote of mine that I made up, right? And don't take offense to it. Viewer discretion advised, but I'm gonna tell you what the quote is. Nobody can hate you more than somebody you gave birth to. Okay, and if you having trouble with that, what does the scripture say? They will be lovers of themselves. They will hate their mothers and fathers. Let me find it. It speaks about this in the Bible. It talks about one of the rappers is going through it right now, Lil Boosie. He did a song about his ungrateful daughter and other people that was ungrateful in his life. And this girl just snapped and went off on him. And hold on. Second Timothy 3:2. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy. So it goes along with what I just said. Nobody can hate you more than somebody you gave birth to. So I've been under a great protection, right? So the protection goes pretty deep. So when somebody asks you, why didn't you see somebody more? First of all, it shows me their lack of faith and understanding of destiny and the way that understanding everybody not meant to be around you. And see, all those deaths, just like we had another black lady, her daughter and granddaughter murdered her and cut her up and put her on the barbecue grill. Stuff like that. That's a man-made death. Now, what happened is she didn't understand she wasn't supposed to be around them. And I don't lack that ability. I have the ability to understand death dates and a man-made death, and I'm not supposed to be around certain people. And how it was proved to me is when I did go to Texas, how violent my relative's father was acting and how passive aggressive he was along with the woman he's with. See, the Lord proved to me, be glad you didn't bring your ass down here sooner, right? So I'm able to read energy and I'm able to feel things. And another thing, y'all, I don't do prisons, right? So I might be more untamed than the damn abuser if you piss me off bad enough, right? So what I do And I'm fortunate because I didn't have a bunch of people on a fucking regular threatening me like that. I mean, see, some people, they lived in environments where they couldn't even take a nap. There was no peace. And I can say this, even though there was some level of abuse in my family element, there was some problems. Overall, I could say this. When I was at my grandmother's and my mother's, I slept well. So I'm saying that to say this. I wasn't one of them kids where I was just like all my life, every day, I just remember it being a literal hell because these abusers was around. So I'm not comfortable with it. And I thank the Lord for that. But disobedient children, nieces, nephews, grandkids, and stuff like that, they do a lot of out-of-pocket stuff that really runs a lot of parents and grandparents off. Like one thing, okay, going to court, turning on your mama and daddy, getting your damn siblings taken, then you're removed from my environment or whatever environment you're in when kids do this type of stuff, then take your ass to another state and you want to call somebody else your damn mama or daddy or, you know, and that's a thing like that mom word, mama. Don't expect your damn mama or daddy to come see you. Okay. See, I've always been the type of person, y'all. And I think it's like, it's a mentality of how a pimp would think. I just couldn't do the job. However, if the Lord said, you know what, you got to be a pimp for a week, I could do the job because I know not to let nobody play me like that. And that goes along with the ungratefulness. And them type of situations is how me, myself, when people are treating me that way, that's how I would be put in an early grave site. I mean, you got to read the red flags. I just wonder, like that black lady where her mom, where her daughter and granddaughter murdered her, chopped her up, and then decided to cook her on the barbecue grill. She missed the red flags of the bitches. And those are the red flags that I don't miss. And I take them very serious. I don't do violence. I just don't do violence like that. And the result is, I didn't end up in the casket. Okay? I just didn't end up in the casket. And I can't. I think if someone else asks me that question, if someone else asks me, well, why didn't you see the person more? I would answer it like this, because they're not my God. That's why. I'm waiting to see the Lord. And see, that's the point I make with my children too, and my family members. That's one of the things they will learn about me before either one of us die. They're not my Lord. Going to see them for what? And it's borderline disrespectful when someone asks you that and they know you did not have a good relationship with the person. It doesn't matter whether it's your granddaughter, your daughter, your son, your grandson, nieces and nephews. Why ask somebody that? For one, they're deceased now. You can't bring it back. You can't take it back. You didn't go see them and they didn't come see you because it was a toxic relationship. And now you're not a part of a man-made death and you didn't have an early death date. And that's why you didn't see them, because the Lord didn't have an early death date for you. Because remember, a lot of this is choices. Going to visit people that have stood up in superior courts and told a bunch of damn lies, got your children taken, called you a bunch of bitches the same day. Then the damn baby daddy ain't no goddamn better. Then come back to visit you when they 18, wanting to fight you in your own freaking house. Then you go send it back or send her or him back. This is the type of stuff. Some of them coming in your house and beating the hell out of your kids that's there. You got older relatives coming back just kicking the kids' ass, kicking the elderly people's ass. It's so many different situations. Some of them come back to your house and sell drugs all over your damn house. So, okay, you have somewhere to send the person, whether it be male or female, and you don't see them no more. And sometimes the next time you see them, it is at their funeral. But you continue to talk to them over the phone. A lot of people wouldn't even talk to those kind of people over the phone. So what it is if I was asked that question again, I would have a better answer. For one, I would say this. They wasn't my Lord, and I have stronger boundaries, and I know how I'm supposed to be treated. And don't expect nobody to come see you when you start calling someone else who they are or who you are. Like if that's your, if you're their grandpa or grandma, and this particular grandson or granddaughter starts calling somebody in another state, their grandpa, cut contact. Cut contact. I mean, it ain't no, you can't live life allowing people to play you like that. One of the worst things you can have is too low a self-esteem. That's why you got people running around suicidal. And I ain't one of them. And I don't mess with those type of situations because they not my Lord. And I believe in people being good to me, y'all. I played that little excerpt from the song. And maybe that's what I'll say. Maybe I'll never be asked that question again. But if I'm ever asked that question, if I'm ever asked, why didn't I go see somebody that's passed away? I'll say, maybe I'll play this for them. Listen to this, y'all. And I'll say they wasn't good to me. Because there's nobody that can hate you more than somebody you gave birth to, y'all. I love y'all so, so much. Please like, share, and subscribe. Never forget that. 2 Timothy explained it too. I read the scripture, y'all. So have a beautiful day. I love y'all. I got my sweet tea here. And I appreciate you so, so much. May the Lord bless you always. And tune in for more. Thank you for tuning in to Advanced Insight.